All right. So next is David Cunningham. David Cunningham is the deputy director of Institute of Modern and Contemporary Culture at the Westminster University. And he's also the long-standing the member of the collective, editorial collective of the Journal of Radical Philosophy, and widely has written on architectural issues, urban and architectural issues. And I have to say selfishly, I just counted that David has contributed to my last five books. sorry to mention this. Just to give you an idea that he has really, from outside of the discipline of architecture, I'm sure many, we appreciate David's contribution to our discipline. Please, David.
Thank you, first of all, to Nadir and Doug for the invitation. It's a real pleasure to come and speak at what's at least partly a celebration of the publication of these two books, which I've been privileged enough to play a very minor role in each. I didn't realize I'd written now five contributions to Nadir's books. I'm going to have to stop doing that, I think. I'm just going to repeat myself eventually. What I'm not going to thank them for is making me go off to my other friend Nina, because I fear what I'm going to say is going to seem rather tediously academic in some ways after Nina's talk. What I hope it does take up in part are some of the things that Nina was talking about towards the end of her paper around the question of what sense it makes to want to resurrect the public, and in particular in its relation to this tricky term, the polis. In a way, this is a paper not really about neoliberal or neo-baroque architecture themselves, but about a particular response to the problems posed by neoliberal or neo-baroque architecture, and what I take to be a problematic or failed response to it. I'm coming somewhat into the belly of the beast here, because the target of this, as you will see, is Pier Vittorio Orelli, with full respect to much of Orelli's work, which is constituted in some ways around a very particular conception of the political in relation to the polis, and what I think are the problematic, both classicizing and formalizing consequences of this conception of the political as a means of thinking the repoliticization of architecture. So it's a kind of partly written paper. The slides are merely for decoration rather than illustration, shall we say. So while they continue to enjoy a near hegemonic status in the upper echelons of much contemporary architectural education, it is clear that the convergence between neoliberal ideologies of a spontaneous order attributed to the market and would-be radical calls to architectural self-organization, deterritorialization, or flexibility, understood as one legacy of the critiques of modernist planning of the 1950s and 1960s, register an ongoing transformation in the modern conjuncture of architecture and capitalist development, which the financial crises of 2008 have done little to interrupt. This is my gesture towards Doug's book, and my next paragraph will be a gesture towards Nadir's book. In the face of architecture's re-enchantment, in the service of phantasmagoric spectacle, and the reduction of the architect's role to a form of city branding, addressing the packaging of buildings and cities rather than their social content, as one group of commentators describe it, the desire to recover what Manfredo Tafuri termed a specifically political dimension has then an obvious appeal, not only in architectural theory, as recent debates around the supposedly post-political attest. Among the many merits of the writings of Pier Vittorio Orelli, to take one currently influential example, would therefore be the relatively straightforward ways in which they seem to pose a repoliticization of architecture against the economic logics of neoliberal managerialism, or indeed capitalist development tout court, one which would not so much seek to articulate a new political project for architecture as it would reassert the intrinsically political character of architecture qua architecture itself. In light of the question of whether under neoliberalism we are governed by politics at all, as Orelli puts it in the introduction to his 2011 book, The Possibility of an Absolute Architecture, it is precisely architectural form which may theoretically be mobilized against the dominant ethos of urbanization, that within the rise of capitalism has characterized, Orelli argues, a metropolitan and globalizing modernity in general. Most importantly, perhaps, it is in its identification with what he calls a project of the finite as a condition not only of architecture, but of thinking and enacting the political as its own imminent field of action, which thus shifts the significance of architectural form itself from a primarily aesthetic to a political register. Architectural autonomy is reconceived, that is, not as a renunciation of politics, but as that which is achieved in and through the positing of an autonomy of the political as such. Consequently, the claim is not only that form is political, but that a political is itself formal in its very essence. Architecture becomes resolutely itself, it's a quote from Morelli, where, like the island distinguished from the metropolitan sea, it takes as its condition to separate and be separated. And insofar as politics itself is, according to Morelli, only ever constituted as, quote, an agonism through separation and confrontation, it can be placed alongside the process of separation inherent in the making of architectural form. The formal and the political are, as Morelli puts it, overlapping categories, in which each serves the ultimate realization of the other. So part of my interest here is that, not simply to have a go at Morelli, but in a sense to see Morelli as, in some ways, revealing by thinking architectural form as political about certain formalizations of the political more generally. There was a certain tendency, in part in response to neoliberalism, to rethink politics itself in fundamentally formal, and therefore I'll go on to argue, ahistorical terms. In the context of current enthusiasms for the autopoiesis of free market order and the demand, to quote Patrick Schumacher, to remain networked all the time, I've borrowed this quote from Doug's excellent book, the attractions of some politicized project of autonomy and separation are not hard to see, as is indeed the case for recent turns to a rhetoric of withdrawal, secession, or exodus in left-wing politics more generally. Yet it also comes at a high price. Indeed, in effectively severing politics from the historical realities of capitalist development, it results, I want to argue, in not only an architectural formalism, but in an abstract formalism of the political itself, which can thus only elide or efface the changing social forms through which any actual politics, including architectural politics, is made possible. If Morelli's argument here is, then, in interesting ways, symptomatic of larger issues concerning how we are to understand the nature of the political project of what is most usually termed neoliberalism, and in particular of the economic logics of a certain depoliticization associated with it, one of the kind of central paradoxes, I take it, of understandings of neoliberalism of whatever stripe, is that it is, in a sense, an emphatically political project which seeks to depoliticize. It also draws out, I think, some of those problems endemic to the specifically formalizing appeal to something like a quasi-ontological essence of the political that has underpinned at least one substantial part of the theoretical left's response to this, to neoliberalism. In this regard, Morelli's identification of the making of form with a project of separation from the economic picks up many of the echoes of a familiar and rather broader refrain going back not only to the 1960s, and to, for instance, the different strands of both Italian workerism or post-Althusserian philosophy, but in fact to the very first decades of the 20th century and to a framing of socialist or communist politics precisely against a certain orthodox Marxist tradition, as Morelli himself puts it, in such a way as to identify as its most extreme, quote, not the degree of autonomy of one level from the other, but the autonomy of political power to core with respect to economic determinations. The tick in Morelli's writing of the term tout court is an interesting one here, that the politics must always be tout court separated from the economic. So where then earlier theorizations of autonomy in architectural discourse is what K. Michael Hayes terms the most important operative concept of architectural theory at the moment of its refoundation in the 1970s, tended to shuttle back and forth between a kind of abstract celebration of the self-referentiality of the aesthetic and a disenchanted acceptance of the tragic as a historical consequence of an effective enforced isolation, for which in various ways the later Mies van der Rohe and Aldo Rossi have become a particularly emblematic figures. The significance of Morelli's own theoretical intervention lies in an affirmation of architecture's capacity for not only a resistant but a productive autonomy from the dominant socio-spatial dynamics of the metropolis that would be constitutive of its political significance as such. It is this that thus presents, Aureli argues, a kind of symbolic power manifested in the urban fragment or island. One of his favourite images is that of the archipelago, taken from Unger's, to imply the ways in which precisely the city as polis, and hence as political form, might be reborn from within but against the forms of existing capitalist urbanisation. So there is a distinction, tout court, between the polis as urban form and what is called urbanisation, which is, I think, significant here. Among other things, of course, this allows Aureli to generate a powerfully simplified, if somewhat Manichaean, narration of modern architectural history as a whole, in which more or less the entire architectural field can thus be divided into two opposing camps or extremes, represented by, on the one hand, Rossi, Mies, Unger's, Etienne-Louis Boulay, Piranesi, Palladio, etc., and on the other by Giovanni Battista Nolli, Cerda, Ludwig Hilbersheimer, Archigram, Cedric Price, Archizum, and Superstudio, albeit perhaps critically and ironically in the latter two case, and so on. If the second grouping embrace what Aureli argues are in this sense, essentially economic logics of an ever-expanding and all-encompassing urbanisation, in which the individual architectural object is placed in crisis by virtue of a collapse of formal limits, the first recovers the architectural event as political by insisting on the, quote, finite and thus separated character of the architectural event itself. In doing so, it thereby makes explicit and tangible, Aureli argues, the inexorable separateness of the city as opposed to the urban or the metropolitan. The inexorable separateness of the city as opposed to the urban or the metropolitan. Such islands in the sea of urbanisation confront and contest the forces of the latter through, quote, their explicitness as forms, as punctual, circumscribed facts. Now, it is, I think, a sign of the classicising force of this conjecture that this is an opposition ultimately traced back not only to the rise of capitalism in the late Middle Ages, which was, after all, as Marx implies, itself reliant upon the separated enclaves of the commercial city in distinction to its surrounding feudal landscape, but to the putative origins of Western or European urban society as such. Between that is what Aureli describes as the insular logic of the Greek polis, a city strictly framed by its wall exterior, and the Roman urbs, which represents the expansionist and inclusive logic of the Roman territories. As opposed to the accumulative logic of the economic, precisely because politics is, quote, incarnated in the polis, writes Aureli, the project of the city holds the possibility of conflict and the need for its resolution as its very ontological foundation. Through its act of separation and being separated, architecture reveals at once the essence of the city and the essence of itself as political form. And it's the connection between its revealing of the essence of the city, what that entails, and its essence of it as political form that's partly interesting to me here. When it comes then to 20th century architecture and urban modernity, moving forward some two millennia, it is then the quasi-ontological status of such separation and of the image of the city within the city, or rather the city within the metropolis, precisely as a political project tied to the historical urban form of the polis, that is rendered at stake too for Aureli in what is, for example, in many ways the centrepiece of the discussion of architecture and politics in his first book. The dispute, that is, between Tafuri and Mario Tronti in their respective analyses of Red Vienna and the German social democratic urbanism of the interwar years of the 20th century. Famously, Tafuri argues in a 1971 essay that since the idea of socialism envisaged in the architecture of Red Vienna was an essentially, quote, moral idea directly confronting the objectivity of the capitalist order, the autonomy of the political founded on it becomes a kind of subjective voluntarism that could only be symbolic. Even in large, Tafuri argues, to a quasi-urban scale, projects like Karl Ehren's famous Karl Marxhof in Vienna or May Siedlung Rommestadt in Frankfurt built utopias at the edge of an urban reality very little conditioned by them, according to Tafuri, could not escape, whatever their intentions, the dislocating effects of a metropolitan reality governed by capitalist development and the abstractions of the money economy. The possibility of a mediation, Tafuri writes, between the controllable fragment and the urban whole ends, however, in a search for an identity that merely cancels the uncontrollable, lays it aside at least, presenting the selection made as a totality in its very separation. Now, you'll be ready to know, I don't want to linger too much upon the historical specificities of this debate, but it's not too hard to see then that the problem of autonomy is, so to speak, already pitched by Tafuri at a rather different level here. For what is at stake in this debate has as such to be understood not as an ontological or transhistorical division within the understanding of different urban forms, but as part of a precisely historical discussion internal to workerism and autonomism, concerning the necessary conditions for what, for example, Raniero Panzieri termed workers' control. Notably in this regard, Tafuri's pivotal claim in Architecture and Utopia that the political function of architecture could lie only in its ability to place, quote, the working class as organised in its parties and unions, face-to-face with the highest levels achieved by capitalist development, is in this sense far more in line with Tronti's own arguments of the 1960s than Aureli supposes. Something which is reflected, for example, in Tafuri's assessment of Martin Wagner's plan following his enrolment in the SPD in 1919 for both the politicisation of technique and the socialisation of the building industry, which Tafuri argues was in reality an instrument for the control of the labour force, more than for the control of productive objectives on the part of the working class themselves. To put it another way, it is not the formal act of separation that might be identified in such projects that constitutes their autonomy alone here, but the broader social basis that underpins the possibility of such autonomy itself, that is, the organisation of the working class in its parties and unions, an autonomy which is thus always historically composed. In fact, what this means for the autonomy of politics or the political per se remains a point of some ambiguity in Tronti himself, or rather his simultaneous claim for the autonomy of the political and, as he writes in 1964, the necessity of, quote, a strategic support for capital's development in general is only really held together by that claim underlying Tronti's most famous articulation of workerism itself. That is, the need to invert a classical Marxian concept that, quote, puts capitalist development first and workers second, and instead turns the problem on its head. At the level of socially developed capital, Tronti writes, capitalist development becomes subordinated to working class struggles. It follows behind them, and they set the pace to which the political mechanisms of capital's own reproduction must be tuned, end quote. While Aureli's account in the Project of Autonomy book maintains at least some link with this thesis, its subsequent development has, shall we say, a considerably more questionable relation to it. Tellingly, Tronti largely disappears from the theoretical background to the 2011 book, The Possibility of an Absolute Architecture, to be replaced instead by the writings of Giorgio Agamben and Chantal Mouffe, and by what is itself a quasi-ontological definition of the political as, quote, agonism through separation and confrontation. That is most obviously indebted not to workerism, but to the left Schmittian political philosophy of the latter, that is, of Chantal Mouffe. Yet the difficulty is that without the specific Trontian inversion of the relative primacy of workers' struggles and capitalist development as a kind of motor of modernity, the slogan of the autonomy of the political risks in its connection to architecture simply dissolving at this point into a kind of free-floating voluntarist politics of form that is imagined to exist somehow free of all social mediation altogether, an act of pure separation necessarily ungrounded in any specific historical conditions. I would not be the first to note that there is a rather obvious irony in this respect, that a current resurgence in assertions of the autonomy of the political in general, from Badiou and Rancière to Mouffe to various strands of post-autonomia and the ultra-left, should take place at precisely the very moment in which the globalisation of capitalist modernity and the hegemony of so-called neoliberalism tends to confirm the ways in which, in line with Marx's own general argument, economic interests overdetermine social relations, including those of politics itself. By contrast, the debates in which both Tafuri and Tronti were involved, and upon which Aureli seeks to draw in his first book, have to be understood against a very different, as it were, pre-neoliberal historical backdrop, that of an analysis of the long shift from laissez-faire capitalism and 19th century liberalism to so-called monopoly capitalism, welfarism, or what Tronti simply terms socialized capital. In this context, Tafuri's critique of architectural ideology, for example, has to be read as part of a wider exploration of the role played by what both he and Tronti call the plan as a new form of political management of social relations, driven at root by capital's need to reintegrate the working class as labour power and to recuperate, quote, a real general terrain of the class struggle, which can thereby be consciously regulated and organised. The crucial point is, at any rate, that it is from this historically specific conjuncture that Tronti derives his own seminal claim that it is the oppositional force and resistance of the working class which functions as the active component in capitalist development and so constitutes the basis for the latter's autonomy. However, the notion that this is thereby applicable to the relation of capital and labour across its entire history and can therefore be formalised as such is considerably more questionable. Or to put it really simply, we don't live in Tronti and Tafuri's times anymore, and it's problematic to pretend that we do. What Aureli in this sense wants to take from Tronti concerning the autonomy of the political is thus effectively unmoored at this point in the face of what in a recent text Tronti himself calls the neoliberal capitalist restoration from the very specific historical grounding which Tronti himself had given it. The result is both to profoundly dehistoricize Tronti's arguments and more disturbingly to dehistoricize the political itself. In the possibility of an absolute architecture, an effectively formalist politics, an accompanying politics of formalism, thus appears for modernity at least more or less transhistorical, reiterated from Palladio to Ungers, each understood as effectively the same act of separation and finitude, even as that which it is posed against, i.e. capitalist urbanisation, continues to transform and extend itself, not least through those transformations that a concept of neoliberalism seeks to register. Consequently, the articulation of an autonomous sphere of the political cannot but be thought here as entirely abstracted from the social relations of political economy as such, not so much by eluding, but by simply eliding the central context of actual capitalist social relations themselves. By contrast, of course, to Fourier's final judgment on the failures of realised social democracy in the interwar years, for example, that they were not metropolitan enough, makes a point which is, in its historical specificity, not so distant from Tronti's own identification of working class struggle with the forces of modernity. It is for this reason, of course, that as Aureli acknowledges, someone like Hilbersheimer's metropolitan architecture would constitute for Tafuri the most sober and realist of the modernist engagements with the urban, or the most sober and disenchanted, perhaps, confrontations with the urban, as posed, quote, against the fragmentation of the cooperative islands and against the utopia of an architecture that realises a socialist humanism. As Tafuri writes of the images of Hilbersheimer's modernist architecture, quote, they refer to an other order representable only as abstractions, end quote. But the abstraction at stake here is, of course, not only formal or theoretical, although it is also that, but it is a real abstraction. Or rather, the abstraction of the formal is the governing sociality of capitalist reality, as it is for the capitalist metropolis, to the degree that it is, in Simmel's phrase from 1903, dominated by the money form, and by the new forms of impersonal and abstract social relationality accompanying it. From this perspective, if the very notion of the political itself is not to drift into mere archaism, it must also entail a coming to terms with this seeming ineliminability, and indeed in some sense necessity, of social abstraction, not merely narrowly economic abstraction in all modern urban life. It's crucial, of course, in Marx that although commodity exchange and so on are forms of economic abstraction, as forms of economic abstraction, they're also more generally forms of social abstraction, that the economic is itself a social form, as the political is. Part of the problem, however, is that the claims to the ontological character of the separation of the political and economic tout court rests itself in Aureli and others, less upon any developed account of capitalism or neoliberalism themselves, as it does upon an effectively reifying classical and thereby historical conception of the polis as such, exemplified in, say, Aristotle's discussion of money and exchange in Book One of the Politics, and of the threat the latter poses to what Aristotle describes as the order of the polis and to the proper role within the city of oikonomia, the roots of economy, as subordinated to political life. Famously, this concerns in Aristotle the potential for ruinous escalation, as Joseph Vogel describes it, associated with the monetary function in general, and with the spatial expansion of trade, whereby the natural, the term used in Aristotle, limits of commonality constituted by the polis are destructively breached. The aberrant use of money, as Vogel puts it, thus raises the spectre of the ruin of the polis and its communal form. When Aristotle subsequently defines such boundlessness as manifestly unnatural, what he has in mind is, in the first place, a departure from the series of political goals, a rejection of communal involvements, and a depoliticization of the political bond. The proportions of commonality grown indistinct. It's a quote from Vogel. Evidently, it is this that calls to restore, or simply to recognize, an autonomy of the political as a means to a repoliticization of the political bond aimed to reverse, as a means effectively of recovering the appropriate proportions of commonality against the threat of abstraction. Yet their cost is what must thus be regarded as an ahistorical and ultimately archaic conception of the political itself, an archaism sustained only by an abstract separation from the economic as itself a fundamentally social form. Indeed, there is a sense here in which what Aureli and others seek, not without good reason, to oppose is not so much critiqued here as it is simply inverted. The open, flexible, networked, and connective abstract forms of the metropolis, which Aureli associates with the endlessness of the Hegelian bad infinite and of commodity exchange, are counterposed to a set of inverted principles that are equally abstract in their entirely formal and reified presentation: the closed, the separate, the bounded, and the finite. If the latter are thus identified with what is, as Aureli puts it in a telling phrase, proper to the architectural and to the political, in neither case can there be any consideration of the actual social and historical conditions under which such an essence is itself reproduced. Consequently, while the opposition between architecture and urbanization, polis and metropolis, the political and the economic, may be subject to some sort of intensification, structurally it cannot apparently ever change. What is proper to architecture, or more specifically architecture as form, is precisely only constituted through its abstraction from any socio-historical mediation. In fact, I think Aureli himself comes close to registering the problems of his position in his own account of Mises' late projects as absorbing and transforming the reifying forces of urbanization, as manifested in someone like Hilbersheimer. Since here, on this account, the abstraction of architecture is conceived simultaneously as both separation and removal from the social reality of the capitalist metropolis, and yet as the continuity or mimesis of that very reality itself. However, the problem is that the entirely formal and thus one-sidedly abstract understanding of the political, through which the idea of a persistent autonomy of architecture is maintained, must ultimately undermine this more dialectical account, relocating it in some ontologized and ahistorical conception. To Fourier's comment on Aldo Rossi that the absolute estrangement of form creates an emptied sociality at the center of his architecture is here transferred, in other words, to the very form of the political as such. And I'm going to...
Well, thank you for the invitation. I want to open by saying that it's interesting that this event is bringing two very divergent political and art historical understandings of the world together, the neoliberal and the neo-baroque. This raises a number of questions that I think are worth pursuing in itself. What does it mean, as this event suggests, to pair these two frameworks together as a means to describe our present? How can we confidently draw upon two completely different references of history, one grounded in our historical knowledge and the other emerging from economic and social theory, to make a very coherent statement about subjectivity today? Clearly, over the past few decades, there has been a tendency in the world of architecture to incorporate geometric complexity, iconic curvatures, and form-making that might recall the folding voluptuousness and immersive interiors of Baroque architecture. We might also note the similarities by which these two architectural tendencies operated within similar oligarchic forms of patronage. Is it here where the neoliberal and the neo-baroque might converge today? If we recall that a certain endpoint in the discourse of neoliberalism arrives in the way we think about environments and how the environment conditions economic subjects, then we can perhaps see how today's immersive, sensorially attuned architecture is in fact part of the economics of neoliberalism. With this, I am of course referring to a term that Foucault mentioned briefly in his lectures at the Collège de France, namely environmentality, which speculates on the economic logic that seeks to co-opt and instrumentalize urban space and architecture as a tool to seduce the famous homo economicus, the economic man, or the human subject who accepts reality. And it is in this sense that we might call neo-baroque geometries and sensorially immersive strategies so common today can perhaps in this way can further be augmented by another form of sensorial intervention, namely cybernetic infrastructures and ubiquitous computing. You might recall the work of Jennifer Gabris recently. So yes, if indeed neoliberal urban spaces and their neo-baroque geometries operate on the sensorial through enchanting and digitally enchanted environments, if the sensorial is now a central realm of urban and architectural techniques that respond to neoliberal agendas, then it might be useful to consider again the question of disenchantment as a possible political project today. But what will it mean to do so? This leads me to my second question that this symposium raises for me. Is the notion of disenchantment, in fact, the right entry point to construct a politics of resistance today? Does it still hold today, as it did for Max Weber, that a kind of intellectual disenchantment, a rejection of value, will free the subject from mechanisms of commodification? Indeed, how can disenchantment maintain a radical capacity in a world in which disenchantment itself has already been commodified? I would like to suggest that an entry point into this question might be found, perhaps not in disenchantment, but in a parallel term, namely wonder, or what is known as with the Latin admiratio. The English term, of course, fails to capture its full meaning. Its conceptual history will reveal several of its connotations, ranging from admiration, reverence, magic, miracles, marvels, all of which cannot be reduced to what today we might refer as wonder. By looking at wonder, we will begin to see not only the fleeting psychological effect of confronting something rare, but in fact, we will get closer to the convergence of ideas that are historically rooted in philosophical, theological, and aesthetico-political discourses. Wonder is important for our conversation, not only because it was a paradigmatic cultural mechanism whose use was generalized during the Baroque, but also because in the 17th century is the moment in which the notion becomes instrumental in a wide process of social transformation that sees the realm of sensorial experience and the role of affects as a new ground on which to test new forms of subjectivity. It is in this context that the theater becomes a crucial medium for experimentation. In fact, an important play, part of my presentation today, will be the analysis of a play retrospectively titled L'Impresario. This is one of the only surviving records of Bernini's role as playwright, which was relatively recently discovered. But before I get into this play, I believe it is crucial to touch on moments on the conceptual history of wonder, as it will allow us not only to better situate the relevance of the play, but also to trace historically how wonder is part of the cycle of becoming. As we will see, wonder is embedded in a process which draws attention to phenomena and calls for the desire or the capacity to bring that which causes wonder into the realm of human understanding. In other words, wonder is also coupled with its own process of de-wondering. This was, of course, clear in classical philosophy, where wonder in the ancient Greek taumazein was used to denote the beginning of philosophy. As Socrates shows here, wonder is the only beginning of philosophy. But wonder was also used to denote the act of overcoming such encounter by aiming precisely for the contrary. As Aristotle stated, all men begin by wondering that things are as they are, but we must end with the contrary. Yet perhaps even more important for me today is to reflect for a moment on the understanding of admiratio by Thomas Aquinas. In his Summa, Aquinas was one of the first to distinguish between different forms of admiratio, separating the general experience of admiration from that of miracles. The word miracle, Aquinas stated, is taken from admiratio. Now we experience wonder, I'm quoting, when an effect is obvious but its cause hidden, but the word miracle connotes something altogether wondrous. In doing this, building on Aristotle metaphysics, Aquinas separated miracles, miracula, from other sources of admiration, such as marvels or mirabilia. A miracle, Aquinas proclaimed, is described as difficult not because of the worth of the matter about which it occurs, but because it surpasses the capabilities of nature. It is termed unusual, not because it might not occur repeatedly, but because it is outside the normal pattern. So what we're confronted with here is an ontological distinction between miracles and wondrous marvels. On the one hand, while marvels are rare, they are also knowable. But on the other hand, miracles for him are not so much related to their exceptionality, but in that they violate the natural order. In other words, marvels are situated as having somehow natural causation and are accessible through the rationalization, whereas miracles are situated in the realm of divine order. So what are the repercussions of this? On the one hand, in elevating miracula to the theological plane, it could be said that he sets free the fascination of his time with the marvelous, with the rarities of the world, with unexplained monstrosities, to be fully explored without any contradictions with theological principles. We have to remember that curiosity is still, at this point, was a debatable topic. It was considered a vice. Just as Aquinas, many contributed to changing the notion, and this is a crucial moment in which the observable phenomena of the world opened themselves to the rationalization. On the other hand, going back to his understanding of miracles, in attempting to legitimize them in relation to divine order, miracles will potentially become more instrumental in the legitimation of Christian beliefs. Aquinas' influence remained relevant for and was crucial to the papacy up to the 17th century. But at the same time, as his distinctions of admiratio were becoming more fundamental, there was an equal impetus to rationalize the marvels of the world in forms that at times precluded its relation to pleasure, which Aquinas had also argued was an important element present in the notion of admiratio. With this, I'm referring to the obsession of many theologians to document miracles. According to historian Vinum, almost contradictory to their mysterious appearances, the records were done in a rather dull factual prose, which flattened altogether their original ability to capture the soul, to elicit awe. Additionally, the impetus to rationalize was also embraced through the many Wunderkammern of the time, as we all know, where abnormal phenomena were enumerated, listed, ordered, and cataloged to stress regularity and understanding of the laws of nature. As we know, these phenomena of rationalization and cataloging only increased by the 17th century. On the other hand, the Wunderkammer became a common sight even within Roman Christian institutions like the Jesuit College. On the other hand, miracles became embedded in something of a bureaucratic practice, for the lack of a better word, where their documentation, the sort of legislation procedures became crucial in their validation. These administrative practices around miracles will become even more urgent as in the context of Counter-Reformation as a belief in post-biblical miracles divided Catholic and Protestant writers. Not only were these tendencies towards the rationalization of order a part of a larger epistemological transition, as we already know, but they were also products of a shift of how papal power constituted itself. For example, historian Paolo Prodi traces the continuous secularization of papal practices from the mid-15th to the mid-17th centuries. He argues that by the 17th century, in an effort of the papal court to assert their temporal power, it developed a number of institutions, administrative practices, and rational techniques embedded in emerging practices of state-like centralization. So we can say that by the 17th century, with the endless rationalizations of marvels, the bureaucratization of miracles, and the development of rational practices within the papal court, all of these reveal a generalized process at the heart of the early modern world of something which, following Caroline Wynum, we call the wandering. Yet, I would like to suggest that this process of the wandering, if we can call it as such, should not only be seen as an effect of the process of rationalization, but also as an identification of a loss that had to be recuperated in order very consciously manufacture objects, artifacts, displays, and spaces. Or to put it differently, the rationalization of wonder also opened the necessity to reconstruct its affective dimension in the realm of cultural production. So just as Wilhelm Flusser suggested, the very moment in which the supernatural and the magical are made legible by mathematical, geometrical, and other forms of scientific knowledge, they immediately begin to inhabit new spheres of life. In other words, paraphrasing Flusser, the progressive scientification of the world is never separated from the transference of wonder to other realms. Of course, we might recall the Wunderkammer that became something of a touristic attraction at the time. In the case of this one, the Jesuit College in Rome, for example, Athanasius Kyrgios was frequented by the most important personalities of the time. Likewise, the miracle stories of saints were often dramatized in sacred opera and other forms of spectacular performances. This was especially the case in Papal Rome in the 17th century in the context of the 30 Years' War. It was then that in the midst of volatile military campaigns, crusades, and diplomatic alliances, the wondrous theatrical effects dominating ceremonial performance of the princely European courts began to serve as a testing ground to experiment with the complex inner world of subjectivity in a campaign carried out in the sphere of passions and the limits of sensual experience. This is at the moment where the role of theater became crucial in providing a medium for such experimentation. This was especially relevant for the papacy of Urbano VIII, Maffeo Barberini, who ruled for most of the 30 Years' War between 1623 and 1644, in his effort to confront the growing claims made against the legitimacy of miracles to persuade the European elite into believing the narratives of eternal salvation and the mysteries of the Church, and to exalt his own power, his temporal power, Urbano VIII will help facilitate a massive campaign to produce, manufacture, fabricate, and stage a world through opera performances and other forms of popular theatrical festivities. Papal power, it will appear, no longer had currency strictly in the control of the afterlife, but increasingly began to cultivate it in the immediacy of the earthly world. This was not only a reminder of the world of the power invested in the traditional Christian church, but was in fact the development of a security mechanism by which to consolidate its secular power through an effective campaign carried out by artistic means and theatrical productions. So it is not that there was no precedent for the role of theater in the papal court before, but the context of the 30 Years' War and the impending shift towards a polycentric Europe urged the papal court to cultivate an increasingly effective dimension of its power. In fact, and this is crucial, the same Paolo Prodi argues that this development in papal ceremonial and courtly procedures serve as a model for the early modern state emerging across Europe. And yet, we should not forget that despite the grand developments of theatrical techniques, such as the use of perspectival scenes, optical illusions, and a renewed interest in the classical theater that were already available by the 17th century. The wide use of the theater that were already available remained largely contentious. So this is in the context in which angels, devils, saints, heaven, hell, miracles, virgins, paradise, purgatory, sacraments, salvations, and temptation all came to the center of the stage under the auspices of the papal court of Urbano VIII Barberini, with more interest, more intensity than ever before. I will insist that this was not simply an attempt to represent these theological figures and concepts, but I will argue it was an effort to cultivate responses of desire and passion around them. So now that we understand the paradoxes of the wandering and the context of the theater of the Roman Papal Court, I would like to turn now to Bernini's role as playwriter, as playwright. In 1644, in the last year of the papacy of Urbano VIII, it is believed that Bernini began writing a comedy which was left, however, incomplete. This play was also left untitled, and retrospectively it was called L'Impresario, a name which invokes the role of the theatrical producer. Of course, we know from his biographies that Bernini played an active role in the papal theatrical productions, but few records remain of his role as playwright. In L'Impresario, Bernini, who was a fervent Catholic and, of course, loyal to the Pope, seemed to have found, however, a medium to reflect upon the conditions affecting the artistic practices of his time. The play narrates the production of a play within a play, where the central focus is the malfunctioning of the stage machines. Or to put it differently, it is a play about the failure of spectacle itself. This play has also been considered an autobiographical writing, as the main character of the play, whose name is Graziano, a theatrical producer who seems to bear some resemblances to the theatrical engagement that Bernini himself undertook. Yet, as theatrical historian Don Alberto insists, the play is never about the man, but about the illusions which are created in the theater and the potential evasiveness of the theatrical experience. Asosh Bescher situates this play as a witty manifesto Baroque art, insofar as it touches on the role of deception, stage machinery, and more importantly for us, the role of wonder. Broadly speaking, the play unfolds around the figure of Graziano, as I already said, who is well known for his wondrous stage machines. In the play, Graziano is co-opted somehow forcibly to devise a comedy for his prince. As he undertakes this project, two plays begins to unfold. On the one hand, we encounter Graziano carefully hiding his theatrical secrets and illusion from other theatrical producers. He is careful to conceal his techniques from others, and especially his knowledge on cloud machines, for which he is famous. On the other hand, we find a Graziano devising his new comedy. Graziano hires carpenters and painters, but he struggles to define the topic of the comedy within the play. In an anxious move, he finally decides to create a comedy based on himself. So he creates a double who's also named Graziano within the play. One who is also a theatrical producer and one who is, of course, with reference to Bernini himself. So I want to bring attention to the crucial scene that I consider is relevant today, and it unfolds around the testing of the cloud stage machinery. This scene is important because it questioned the actual role of cloud machinery. So on the one hand, Bernini centers our attention on those that observe the testing of the cloud machinery, the carpenters who were involved in its construction, a courtier that was in the room, and the servants who were present during this testing. So the carpenters announces the success of their making by envisioning the laugh it will create. The courtier imagines the applause, and the servants, enchanted by their own creation, describes their encounter as evoking a happiness they failed to see in their ugly world. One of the servants described their encounter with the cloud as a piece of paradise brought down to earth. And now, the servant stated, I call myself a happy man. To this, however, Graziano interjects, with the purpose of clarifying at once the role of stage machinery. I'm quoting this in full because it's the most relevant paragraph. Damn you all, stage machines aren't to make people laugh, but to make them gaze in wonder. How the hell is going to marvel at it? Who the hell is going to marvel at this construction? You don't have to be brilliant to see it's only good for a laugh. Ingenuity and design constitute the magic art by whose means you deceive the eye and make your audience gaze in wonder. Make a cloud stand out against the horizon, then flow downstage still free with a natural motion. Gradually approaching the viewer, it will seem to dilate, to grow larger and larger. The wing will seem to waft it, waveringly here and there, then up higher and higher, not just hold it in place with a counter gain. Here, Graziano is clear. The fundamental role of theatricality is not to entertain, to make the audience gaze in wonder, but to make the audience gaze in wonder. While laughing appears circumstantial, wonder must be carefully constructed. It is a choreographed sensation. Graziano was not simply aiming to stupefy his subjects, but I would like to argue the role of this artifice was to reorient the experience of the audience towards a confrontation with their own experience. This is clear as we follow the afterthoughts of the servant named Coviello, who in recounting this encounter with Graziano's clown machine states, I'm no longer Coviello, I am a body without a soul. I'm completely beside myself, I no longer care for this world. You too, beware, don't start longing to see Messer Graziano's things. Why? Because they will strip you of your soul, enchant you, turn you to stone, visions of paradise, things to take your breath away. It will be worth the fingers on one hand to see them. So what can we conclude about the secrecy, the testing, and the experience of wonder, desire with the stage effects of the clouds? First of all, Graziano makes a clear distinction that Descartes also emphasizes a few years later. Just as Descartes argued in The Passions of the Soul, astonishment, which is more of a thunderstroke, was not to be confused with wonder. The difference here lies at the level of cognition, in the ability to think about the encounter. In Descartes' words, astonishment, he states, makes the entire body remain immobile, like a statue, and renders one incapable either of perceiving anything or the object but the face first presented, or consequently, or acquire a more specific knowledge of it. Instead, wonder, for Descartes, was a passion irreducible either to the cognitive or to the sensorial. For him, wonder was a surprise which incites the cognition of the subject, but that, however, did not presuppose a positive or a negative action. It could be said, as Catherine Malibu has already understood, wonder is simply an affective opening. It is a novel encounter which denies neither the capacity to sense nor the capacity to think. It is instead a sort of opening of the possibility for a bond between the cognitive and the sensorial, a call to make the sense, to make sense of the encounter. In the same way, the role of the cloud of Graziano augments the viewer's sensorial experience while opening their cognitive capacity to make sense of its artificial construction on the stage. It is not intended to incite a passive stupefaction. It is not a joyful moment. It is simply the mark of a register of a sensorial and cognitive encounter. As Marianne Freswitt stated, the wonder to be felt by the spectators meant that they also had to be aware of the creative activity of the artist. In other words, the audience encountering the cloud had neither fallen into the illusion of the machinatore, the theatrical production and trickster, nor had they accepted the artificial naturalness of the cloud. Perhaps they simply realized that in order for the collective illusion of the theater to take place, to continue, they had to become part of the theatrical illusion themselves. In this way, what Graziano perhaps longs for is for the audience to call into question not the artifice of the cloud, but the artificiality of their own experience. It is the mark of being affected by the artificiality of a collective experience produced by the theater. As Deleuze stated, the essence of the Baroque entails neither falling into nor emerging from illusion, but rather realizing something in illusion itself. or of tying it to a spiritual present that endows its space and fragments with a collective unity. Now, if we speculate for a moment about the context in which the theatrical performances of the papal court were located, we can begin to see that theater as an experimental device at the dawn of, at the beginning of the modern state, serves as a model from which to reformulate the collective illusion of temporal power. The possibility that its very artificiality can be not only known but accepted is perhaps the greatest discovery of the Baroque theater. So a way to tie all these things together is to recall Spinoza's take on wonder. Spinoza disregarded wonder as a primary passion because he considered it to be a new experience which, in its very novelty, it simply distracts the mind as it fails to recall pre-existing thoughts. For him, wonder is an imagination of a thing in which the mind remains fixed because this singular imagination has no connection with others. In other words, he saw wonder as a sort of cognitive and sensorial suspense, but also, and this is crucial, an encounter which did not presuppose either a positive or a negative capacity for action. So similarly to Spinoza's understanding in the Baroque theater, the evocation of wonder does not define how the subject is to act upon the experience of wondrous encounter. It simply calls for the sensorial and cognitive awareness of the encounter itself. I think that in identifying wonder as a distraction of the mind, Spinoza also reminds us of the capacity to intrude into pre-existing thoughts, the affective capacity to create cognitive ruptures, to displace the subject from his or her own course. I think this is very interesting because what we are talking about here is the capacity of wonder to awaken the body and the soul. And in making clear that the capacity for action is nevertheless ambiguous, Spinoza, as Spinoza stated, in the context of the theater, wonder is an opening that then calls for us to focus on the continuation of the wondrous illusion. As Maraval argues, wonder is a psychological effect that for a few instants brings the forces of contemplation or admiration to a halt, so as to then act more vigorously when they are afterwards released. It could be said that wonder suspends, but only to release. In suspending, in creating an affective opening, it brings to question the conscious decision of closing or continuing such opening, in allowing such a scanter to be either negated or formative to consequence to consequent experiences. Wonder, I would like to insist, operates both by reinforcing the separation between the stage and the audience, while simultaneously binding them in a persuasive relation. In other words, in confronting the illusion of the theater, the audience is confronted not only with the mechanisms of persuasion, but also with the very mechanisms that forms them as subjects. Again, the encounter with the wondrous cloud in L'Impresario is not aimed at making the audience fall into the trickery of Graziano, but to open the audience to the willful reception of theatrical illusions. In doing so, to confront the wondrous stage effects is to confront the audience with their own position as subjects partaking in a collective illusion of power. The moment in which the audience projects themselves into the imaginary play as they participate in a collective illusion cannot be separated from questions of subjectivity. And I just want to leave a few thoughts perhaps for further discussion on the notion of disenchantment. While wonder is, of course, not to be taken as a synonym of enchantment, its proximity to one another might allow us to make conclusions on enchantment and disenchantment from my reflections on wonder. First, disenchantment might not, in fact, be the radical other of enchantment. Just as wonder is not the opposite of the wonderment, but rather a momentary state within a larger process of subject becoming. It's not by chance that for Descartes, wonder had no opposite. Wonder is only a momentary affective opening, a rupture. What is perhaps more important is the moments after, when the subject accepts or not the illusion of the encounter to create its own autonomous reality. This leads me to my second statement. Wonder, as I tried to show, had always been called for the capacity of the subject to respond to a certain encounter, which makes me speculate that affective forms of subjectification are not the result of unquestionable acceptance of reality, as has been as was understood, for example, for Gary Becker, the economist that Foucault mentioned in his discussion on environmentality, but are in fact an act of will. Indeed, what I'm trying to leave here today is that perhaps our attention should not be focused solely on strategies of disenchantment, but rather on capturing a capacity of wonder as a political project, specifically in its capacity to disrupt, to destabilize, to disorient, and also to be recuperated as a seductive dimension of the political. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, I'm just thinking about the political uses that wonder was put to in the 20th century. The philosopher that resurrects the idea of thamaxane, the older term for wonder, and the idea of philosophy as this kind of beginning is Heidegger. Mm. And his claim is really one about kind of opening onto the question of being and the question of fundamental ontology. And I think there is a kind of great political and cultural danger to wonder in the way that it was kind of politically taken up. And it partly has to do with what happens when you evacuate the form of religiosity of religious content and you fill it with something else like nationalism mm-hmm. or a spirit of the people. Mm-hmm. And thinking about the role of clouds in someone like the work of Leni Riefenstahl's Triumph of the Will, you know, where there's precisely almost a kind of structural role for obscuration, like obscurantism, like the cloud represents something which is I've written about before as a kind of Nazi sublime, in a way, this moment of wonderment, of a kind of opening, which is itself extremely dangerous, where ideas of killing for no reason or dying for no reason can precisely be inserted in the name of a kind of occult or a mysticist project. And I think, you know, the other way in which wonderment in the 20th century or wonder was mobilized and it's not dissociated is precisely in the image for this event today as of a kind of Disneyfication and a commodification of a childlike relation to the world, but which is itself also extremely dangerous. You know, that there's something very, very racialized about this form of childlike white wonder. Mm-hmm. And I don't know how we might think of the, you know, wonder in the 20th century without those, that dangerous use of wonderment, precisely.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a question I have, especially today after the elections in the States and the Brexit. So I keep on, I don't stop thinking that we are perhaps in this suspense. And I agree with you. It's I guess one of my objectives was to show precisely that it was it's a very violent thing, this wonder. But I mean I think the way I'm trying to understand it is that it's just wonder is just a fragment out of a process of becoming. And if that is the case, I think maybe what I'm trying to call is to try to understand how to recuperate the capacity to rupture, to disorient. I also think that that unfortunately the notion of disenchantment, which as you said, like it has been commodified already, I don't think it allows to I think, for example, this wonder to a certain extent has become so pervasive, so ubiquity. But I think if we are to understand it only as a segment of a wider process of subjectification, maybe we can attempt to recuperate our capacity to reorient, to really to understand it. And I mean, I think it brings the question of the capacity of the political also to be sensual, to recuperate a certain sensual dimension. I mean, I'm not sure I'm responding to your question, but I think there's always, there's also, like something that Flusser says, is that there's always a transference of the magical, of the supernatural to other realms. And I think, in a way, if this is to happen, then our task is also just also not to negate them because they are childish, or but to try to understand them. So I guess that's kind of what I'm trying
to
do.
Yeah, I mean, I obviously, I think the entire point is to try to understand them. I mean, I just, you know, it might be interesting to think of competing forms of thinking about the cosmos as something which is beautiful and mappable, perhaps, right? Mm-hmm. So not to remove the moment of admiration or wonderment, but also not to allow it to remain so open that it's completely, you know, becomes this very dangerous,
absolutely
mobilized position. Yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks, Yvonne. I really enjoyed that. So I wanted to sort of come back to ask you a bit more about the conversation with Spinoza and this idea of a radical imagination that produces a political agency or self-determination. And I suppose I was wondering, have you done more about, in your work, around his discussion of substance and of the material agency? Because there is a sort of a story of it being a kind of radical
you
ecology.
Mean like Jane Bennett and...
Well, no, not thing. Jane Bennett. I mean, she could be there. I wasn't thinking of people in the sort of current becoming discussion. More around it being someone who is working as a rationalist philosopher. Mm. So there is this whole kind of conversation of power relations and of ratios, which in the discussion of the emotions and of the passions, wonder is one of them. Mm-hmm. But it was also actually about this really specific historical event of this performance, this theatre, and thinking about how, I found that really interesting because it's a very specific encounter. It's an artifice, this whole sort of destabilisation, which I think a lot of performance practices are using now, particularly feminist philosophers. I mean, Judith Butler is using performance practice to produce political critique. So I was interested in that, but it was really actually about the relationship between that 17th, early Enlightenment radical theory of substance and of matter and of the environmental, because your conversation of the environment stays with Foucault. So it was really, you know, there's the aesthetic discussion of atmosphere, which you bring in Turner and so on. But it was more about, that kind of notion of nature, ecology, and the radical imagination. If you had, if you'd been looking at the ecological, the substance aspect.
I mean,
of it,
this is the part of the confession. No? I just submitted my PhD, and I've been pretty much focused on this, on the historical, basically on trying to understand a historical dimension of what we might call a political dimension of affects. I actually started from the questions that you're raising right now. That was the very beginning of my PhD, and I haven't really pursued that further. But it's definitely in my, like, to bring that is definitely part of my thing,
I'm surprised that I've not heard any mention of Max Weber, because I'd always thought that this term, the disenchantment of the world, originated from Max Weber. And I think
it's
that...
at the beginning of the symposium.
Yeah.
Ah, well, I wasn't here. Yeah. But not in your lecture.
Yeah, I mean,
But the term there, I think, was Entzauberung, which means something like literally dismagicking. You had a great deal to say about the church, and I would have thought that in ecclesial history there is a long story of the church's attempt to distinguish between magic and miracle, as well as wonder. The odd thing about modern technology is it's much closer to magic than miracle. I mean, certainly if you brought somebody back from 500 or 600 years ago and looked at all the gadgets that we surround ourselves with today, they would think we're all magicians. I don't think they would think we were terribly religious, but just magicians. So I think there's some kind of space in your semantic field that needs to be made for the concept of magic.
Yeah, I mean, perhaps this is, not aimed to be comprehensive, but I'm more interested, not so much in the question of disenchantment, Max Weber, Schelling. I'm more interested about seeing it not as an opposite, as a relation of opposites, but instead seeing it as a reciprocal thing, as like enchantment already presupposes its disenchantment, in a way.
But I mean, you had a very interesting quotation from Deleuze where he says something like, it's not falling into illusion, it's not coming out of illusion, it's seeing some value in the fact that you are witness to an illusion in itself. And that might suggest that this is somebody who understands that precisely that it's not magic. The person who's taken in thinks it's magic. And there's where your political lapse is.
Okay, thank you.
So you probably concur with William Eggington, who has written a book on Baroque, that the theatre is Baroque is theatre. You would concur with that?
I mean, yes, but I think we can extend that. I don't think, and I think maybe this is when the provocation of thinking about the Baroque and the theater today still remains relevant. I think there are still forms of illusion, forms of, power itself is constituted as an artificiality. So I think there's still some ground to think about it today, so, yeah.
and probably we'll open up discussion when we come to panel discussion, that if disenchantment is related specifically to the problem of enlightenment, then I was wondering how you would, I don't expect now to raise a big question, then how would you relate the word wonder specifically in this context? And I have to say, one of my Lebanese students in Lebanon told me, Nadir, that the enchantment is the most fascinating word in English language. So I was wondering if wonder is the most
I really kind of believe that maybe wonder is a better word to assess it, because I think it doesn't presuppose that we are all in the illusion. I mean, it's not so much about, you know, like enchantment, I think, brings the idea of that you enter into a magical forest and everything is enchanted, but you are the only one that is believing this enchantment and everything else recognizes that there's some artificiality, and I think it's a very instrumental notion, perhaps in poetry, in literature. I can think about like Don Quixote or but I think wonder, I think it to me it has more specificity in this context, because what is crucial for me is what Spinoza says. It doesn't presuppose your capacity to consider it, to act. It calls for an action, but it doesn't tell you whether you have to embrace it or be happy or sad. So I think it allows us a little bit more of room to speculate than just assuming that we're enchanted, that we're in an illusion, perhaps.
Just to follow up with that, I mean, that's what I found really intriguing about your presentation is the way that you are making, it's quite a, perhaps in some ways quite a small, but in other ways quite a very important distinction between enchantment and wonder. And yeah, I'm just kind of fantastically intrigued about the kind of possibility of simultaneously being in a state of wonder as a kind of amazement, but also quickly kind of going back and forth and critically reflecting on the process through which that state is produced.
Yeah.
So it's this, if we put it back in disenchantment and enchantment, those things are kind of rotating quite rapidly, and you're switching back and forward between a kind of cognitive and affective mode in a way that perhaps kind of challenges those. And I think it is very interesting to think about its contemporary resonance. I think to kind of pick up on Nina's point about a kind of fascistic use of wonder, I was thinking during your presentation of what Adorno says about Wagner, which is something different, because his whole point is that you don't get to see the mechanisms at all. And this is how it weaves its magic, this is how it weaves its enchantment. And it takes a kind of critical, reflective work to reveal that, but with what you're looking at, it's simultaneously part of the whole performance or the thing you're looking at. I mean, it's very meta, in a way, the notion of the play within the play, the theatre within the theatre. You're simultaneously enjoying its illusions and their mechanisms are revealed to you.
Yeah.
And I wonder also what, you know, do you think there are moments of that in any forms of contemporary culture?
I mean, after the election, I believe so. Actually, even if you think about it from the perspective of Baudrillard's concept of seduction, so it's not an unilateral relation somehow. You have to, it's a reciprocal relation of you are seduced and being seduced. So I think there's definitely corruption. Like, I can think of endless ways in which we are perfectly at some point, you know, there is some collective illusion that we embrace at some point. I mean, I'm saying we, but like, I just basically think that this intellectual disenchantment has to also be, I think it still holds to a certain extent, but I think there's another part of this reciprocity between enchantment and disenchantment that is operating today too. That if, you know, like if we think on the recent American elections, everybody, you know, like there are these politics of race and nevertheless we saw the results.
Yeah. There's simultaneously a kind of fascination in how it happened.
Yeah.
So what is the mechanism? How can we uncover it? Is it Russian hackers?
Yeah.
And so on.
Yeah. I'm interested to also consider how this will play itself in space today. But I think it's definitely something that we can at least reflect to penetrate on a different way to give some agency to the subject to a certain extent, to not only see it as someone that, as Gary Becker will say, unavoidably accepts reality, but it has some capacity to respond to this, to be receptive in a responsive way, I feel.